Tactical Investigations Northwest. This is the wonderful group that provided us with the display there. I want to thank Joe Reese in the corner of the room. Shout out to Joe Reese for bringing there. Yes. So if you get a chance on your way out the door, check out some of the objects that she has out there. They're really cool. She gave a great presentation at the Oregon Historical Society. So some of you may have seen that, and we're going to have a new presentation right here, but she was nice enough to bring some of those objects for us to check out for us. Also want to remind you, questions, if you could hold your questions until after the presentation right here, so Chet and Joe can do their thing, and we can keep the questions on topic. Sometimes it's easy to get off topic and have a question on another issue, but for the respect of everybody in the room, we have a lot of people here, we want to get through it quickly, and the beer will be flowing, and they may not be happy with you if their question's not related to history or archaeology, so we'll keep it on topic. Joe Recker is our environmental coordinator here at TriMet. Joe, he has uncovered a lot, and you're about to find out right here. He's going to give us a great presentation with Chet. But I always like to say, instead of just the bio, because Chet's done this room, he said, dozens of times, he's given presentations. He's a professor, historian, what else? Former director of Oregon Historical Society. He's like, yeah, let's get going already. But we like to say fun facts about each of them. So for Joe, the fun fact, you have a box set up in your yard to trap bats. Is that the new project?
It's the bat.
A bat house. Okay, I don't know what that's about. Still waiting for the bats. And Chet, tell us a story about walking, not driving, but how much you've walked in your lifetime from walking from the house in Northwest.
Well, I used to live up in Willamette Heights, which is about a mile as crow flies that way. And I would walk to and from work most days down to the Historical Society in Portland State and the UVO School of Architecture. And I think I tallied it up and I've logged about 28,000 miles. So I've literally walked, or not literally, figuratively walked around the world to work and back.
There you go. All right, Joe and Chet, take it away, guys.
Thank you, Sean. So the title of our presentation is Where the Past Meets the Future, Keeping Track of Time. A little pun on the fact that this is a rail project. We've already done our introduction, so we'll get to the next slide here. Thanks for coming, by the way. It's great.
So let me try to set the stage a little bit, and we have not done this. We have looked at these slides before, so just to give you confidence, but we have not done this before, so bear with us. This is Portland now, and in the late 19th century, or probably 1880s or so. We know the train was started running down there in the early 1870s. But I always loved this image of Portland. It really conveys this active Northwest trading city. Huddled along the river on the west side, trains, transportation on the east side. And the river filled with traffic. It's kind of frightening to think that it ever may have been this crowded, but it probably was. But two things that I've always liked about this image, although one of them may be a little bit anachronistic, you've got Indians in a large canoe. Sure, whether they would be out there competing with the steamboats and all. But then you've got a couple of guys in skulls rowing. Would have been the case. And it just, for me, encapsulates the sense that Portland was an exercising town, even in the 1880s or so. So we'll start with that. Oh, there are no bridges yet. You just take ferries across the river. So this to some extent defines TriMet and its long story and its predecessor stories. These are neighborhoods basically defined by sociologists and urban scholars, and four different kinds that I just wanted to point out because they sort of set the stage for us tonight. You've got the Central Business District down here, traditionally, of course, that's now moved across the river and is enlarged. You have stopover neighborhoods. This was a stopover neighborhood at one point, no longer is, but it was. Basically, neighborhoods to which migrants and immigrants arrived. And they would stop over there briefly, maybe a few years, learn the language, get their kids in school, learn a trade, get a job. Once they established themselves, then they would move, I'm speaking generally here, they would move to everyday neighborhoods. Think Northwest Portland, Irvington, Selwood, the more established classic neighborhoods that we think of in Portland. Then there are the Highlands, Portland Heights, Willamette Heights, the other hills, Mount Tabor on the east side. And then further out, you can almost tell how old this map is, the automobile suburbs. But basically, when you think about this, early transit, early streetcar lines from the 1880s up through today, built very much along people understanding who lives where, who needs transit.
So before we get too far, I'd like to just give a brief project overview. If you've been attending these Transit on Taps, you probably have a good understanding of the Portland-Milwaukie Light Rail Project. But just a quick overview, it's a 7.5 mile project. It extends from downtown Portland, PSU, through the central east side into city of Milwaukie and northern Clackamas County. There's 10 stations, 2 park and rides. That's basically the construction project for which we'll be talking about different finds. And then we've thrown in a few other historical research that we've done because of the project, not necessarily because of construction or because of things we've found, but history that we've uncovered. And of course, we're opening September 12th this year on time. So when you deal with archaeological features and artifacts, you really have no idea what's under the ground. So we developed a plan our consultants developed a plan, Archaeological Investigations Northwest, but we work with them to develop a plan in response to the federal law, which is the Section 106 of the Historic Preservation Act. You start off by doing historical research, and the bulk of that research is looking at historic maps. The map shown here is an overlay of just an aerial photo, but you see the different lines, and they reflect where buildings were at different times in history. So this is I don't know if there has the year on here, but let's just say it's 1901. And it shows where individual buildings are, even shows the dimensions, it shows what the composition of the building material was, if it's wood or brick. And basically they were put together by Sanborn Insurance Company because they provided fire insurance, and they really wanted to know what's flammable, what's not, what's a risk near you. So we use these maps, which were prepared over time, and they provide a good history of the layers of development as we're going through different areas. We also did reconnaissance, where trained archaeologists go, and when there's dirt exposed, they can look for indicators of archaeological sites, and they can also do some test digging. But that's basically the limit of what you can do without getting out there and uncovering dirt or uncovering pavement and tearing out buildings and moving things around. And that all happens during construction. So to prepare for that, we have this plan that identifies areas where we think there might be things. And that's when we have trained archaeological monitors that are watching the dirt moving of the construction activity. But for the other areas, we don't have archaeological monitors, but we trained the contractors, the foreman, the construction crew that's out there, the first line of defense. So we give them some indicators of what to look for, and if they start seeing discoloration of dirt or evidence of charred material or brick features or other items, they know to give us a call, and that's when we bring the archaeologist in. So that's pretty much how we were planning to deal with this, and I think it worked pretty well for the most part.
Joe, before you move to the next slide, just some quick history, obviously. We're just about 50 years out from the National Historic Preservation Act of 1966. It went into Congress in 64. Some of us may remember Lady Bird Johnson, First Lady, was really the spearhead behind this. She wanted to get rid of billboards, but she also was looking at historic sites, archaeological sites, cultural sites, and wanted to develop a system for preserving these and then making the information and the materials about them accessible to Americans for a very, I think, noble reason, to enlarge our sense of who we are, our sense of identity. And all of this kind of flowery language is actually written into this act of 1966. So we're coming up on its 50th anniversary, and hopefully we'll be seeing, and you will be reading more about what this act has uncovered, as it were, over the years, including what we have here.
So the plan for this presentation was to go geographically from north to south. Hope that doesn't disorient anyone. But so we have some current or fairly current aerial photos that were done during construction or shortly thereafter. And then I've added red stars just for some of the notable archaeological sites that I'll mention either in depth or in passing. There were actually a lot more than this, so I'm just kind of giving you the highlights. So this is Southwest Portland. This is Lincoln Street right here. The alignment connects right here. The turnaround at PSU goes down Lincoln, and then there's a new aerial structure that then comes down into South Waterfront before going over the river, just for orientation. So here's a great old photograph, same area. This is 1964. Some of you may recall the South Auditorium Urban Renewal District. This is Portland's first experience with urban renewal, perhaps a bit drastic, but here you see there's virtually no buildings left. All of the history had been bulldozed to a large extent and paved over, and new buildings were brought up. And you know, I work in this area now, and it's a nice area, but this is what we're dealing with for Southwest Lincoln, which comes right along here. And I wanted to point out some other feature here. This is the Harbor Drive. This used to be the freeway that I think a lot of people know about that was torn out and became Tom McCall Waterfront Park that we know today. So this feature is no longer in existence. However, you'll see that tunnel right there, and we'll come back to that. So as we're going through the project, particularly along NATO, we came across evidence of that old highway that had been buried. I don't know what other parts of the country you find a highway that's been buried, but we certainly found a few of them here. So this may have been the same kind of embankment retaining wall that was in this old photo. And this photo just gives an indication of what things were like back then. Can't imagine riding your bike on that. You know, people complain about NATO today, and you know, it could be better, sure, but it's definitely a step ahead of that.
You should also know that this is still with us in pieces. It's much of it is under South Waterfront and Oaks Bottom, and further south down toward Lake Oswego. So difficult to get rid of all of this concrete and asphalt. It'll be with us for a long time.
Then our crews unearthed this, which was just a buried concrete. It just looked like a concrete road or something. And then we went around and looked for the edge of it, and we found out that it's hollow underneath, and it's basically that tunnel that was right through here, which has to change our construction plans a little bit. You can't really build over a tunnel. You need to provide some fill in there and provide enough density to put a light rail vehicle over it. But that was just another thing that we found fairly early on the project.
So Portland has gone through a number of plans since the 1840s when it was first laid out. And this was a plan from the early decades of the 20th century. A man named Edward Bennett, Englishman who studied in France, came to Portland at the behest of City Council and a City Beautiful Committee. And he was charged with laying out a plan for the city that would build on a streetcar system, and you could see some of the avenues that he envisioned. Some of them lasted, some of them never were made, especially in the downtown where he planned some wonderful diagonals. And the Bennett plan was a brilliant plan. They put it out for a public vote. It passed 2-1, 1912. So Portlanders really were keen on it. Then city council started to sharpen their pencils and do the numbers and realize just how much it would cost to essentially recreate Portland like Paris. And the plan now still sits on the city hall, city council. But what the plan did was essentially begin to inspire Portlanders to think bigger. It was within 5 years that we then had a planning commission and really got into the formal business of planning the city. And so I always like to point to the Bennett plan as sort of the conception of modern city planning and transit planning. This is another view of a plan for the city in the 1930s, with bridges this time, but nothing on the river. It looks like it. River or something. But there is a waterfront park that was envisioned before Harbor Drive was placed in there. There was first down there, but not Harbor Drive as we know it. So someone had planned for a waterfront park, probably Bennett. And beautiful bridges, as you can see. And again, Bennett had come from Chicago, so the idea of building a series of bridges that crossed the Willamette, similar to the bridges that go through Chicago, was probably part of that vision. And then you look at on the east side, God, I was like, there's a sort of cultural district there, cultural district with housing, what would be to the east of the current freeway. Of course, this plan also still sits on the archives shelves. Then a plan that some of you may know of. This one was developed by Robert Moses, who was the Park and Planning Commissioner of New York City, who came out to Portland in 1943 when the federal government had ordered, by executive order, cities in America to begin post-war planning. Now remember, 1943, we look back and we know where the war was going, but then they didn't. There were a lot of people who said post-war planning. Who knows who's going to win this war? And there was still a lot of nervousness about it. But clearly enough people did. Moses came out here in 43, and he lays out a plan for the city. And this was a man who, he had some great positive qualities, but a couple of problematic areas where he hated transit. He was all for tearing up tracks and laying down asphalt and roads. So his plan envisions a freeway coming down from the north. A freeway, this is, remember, 1943, a freeway enveloping the whole downtown with bridges, freeway bridges at the north and south. The southern bridge was be the Ross Island Bridge. And then he envisioned a new bridge, which has become the Vermont Bridge, up here. And then this freeway, which we essentially have. And Portland planners and others like to castigate Moses for his concrete plans, shall we say. One thing I do like to remind people, this was a plan for the city. He also, in addition to all of the concrete that he basically ordered Portland to build with, he said, the other things you people are going to need are better bridges, better schools, better parks. And then he concluded his remarks to city council by saying, and you have to buy 6,000 acres up in the hills that the Olmsted brothers had laid out in their 1903 plan. And that became Forest Park. Now, he wasn't the father of Forest Park, as others had thought of it, but it was his plan that really laid the groundwork for it.
I think one thing else I remember from the Moses plan, I worked at ODOT briefly and I actually had it in my hand at one point, is that he had actually recommended, correct me if I'm wrong, that the I-5 on the east side should actually be pulled in like 7 or 8 blocks so that we had access to the waterfront. Something that I think a lot of people wish today.
The other part about unfortunate plan is he did envision a series of freeways about every 25 blocks going all the way to the east, which would have chopped up the city like a checkerboard. And this was one of the Moses ideas, and it ultimately was hardened into an ODOT plan, the late 60s, the Mount Hood Freeway, which would come off the river here and headed up basically through Division Hawthorne District out to toward Mount Hood, hence the Mount Hood Freeway. This was, of course, stopped in the early 1970s by the new city council. And you can, of course, still see the ghost of this road when you drive off the Markham Bridge and you see spur lines that go off into seemingly nowhere but are blocked. Those were to connect to these ramps that would have carried people up through southeast Portland.
So I was looking at this picture with someone else earlier today, and this is Division Street, basically. And the Portland-Milwaukie alignment comes right through here, right past this Northwest Natural Site, and then right through here. So that's kind of relatively, this is some history, that alternate history that never really happened in the corridor. So some of the other things we found in the downtown portion of the alignment were just fully intact trolley rails and cobblestone streets. And I thought that would be really exciting for a lot of people, but then when I got here and I looked outside, there's a cobblestone street. Hey, that's not where I live, but okay.
Before you, well, you could go to the next one, Joe. I was just going to comment, when these were preserved and when TriMet planned to use them in the downtown and through Old Town, the concept was to reuse the what was called Belgian block, which is a word you, many of you know, which are owned essentially by the Parks Bureau because they had the land on which to store them. And many of the cobblestone streets of Portland were cobblestoned with this Belgian block. And when TriMet announced this, the stories were all about the origin of the Belgian block, that they had been ballast in ships that had come over from Europe, and then they were thrown off the decks into piles on the docks, and then the ships were reloaded with wheat that then headed back out to sea. And that was the prevailing theory briefly until a number of us reminded people that there are several basalt quarries close by, which really was the origin of these. But I also like the idea that probably the hands that made these, that carved these blocks, were by and large foreigners, probably Italian stonemasons who carved so much of the wonderful stone and brick we have in town.
So we uncovered quite a bit of this Belgian block through the alignment, not just on the west side, but also on the east side, around 11th and 12th Avenues and Milwaukie Avenue. But what we did is, in city law requires, if you find 150 more or more of these blocks in a street prism, you need to set them aside and then send them to the Parks and Rec Bureau where they have a site. Oops, which is this site right here. It's a picture when I went there. A lot of these were actually taken from our construction activities. And then I was biking on Sandy not too long ago, and I saw these great new stormwater planters. And I noticed that those look like really nice blocks, probably uncovered by our project. So they're already being put to use. And we're actually using some of these blocks in some sidewalk improvements that we're doing on Southeast Gideon, so you'll be seeing more of them.
It's to prevent skateboarders from going on the sidewalk.
So one of the more intricate sites that we came across, this is at 4th and Lincoln. This is 4th Street right here. Lincoln here is where the alignment comes in. And you can see this is a Sanborn map overlay. There's just a whole bunch of different buildings there. And I put the red star there, but we found things here and here and here and here. Just a lot of evidence of the habitation. In the early 1900s, this used to be an ethnic Jewish neighborhood of immigrants, and they had a lot of shops, and it was a really dense community right here. So when we first started, we noticed that there was a hole in one of the properties we acquired, and this is going to become a staging site for the construction crew. We're like, whoa, who did that? That's not us. But apparently the previous owner had an environmental company removing their underground storage tanks. This was a budget rent-a-car, and they inadvertently found this nice little shaft feature that then we needed to deal with. But they left a whole bunch of dirt right there. So this is that we sent our archaeologist in. We found out it's about 4 feet wide. It's brick shaft. It was likely, if you look at that Sanborn map, it's probably right behind one of the back stoops of one of these residences. So it was very common back then to have your outhouse right behind your home, and in the eight rather than inside. They didn't have plumbing necessarily, but in 1889 is when Southwest Lincoln actually got a sewer installed on there. So until then it was in use, but in 1889 and afterwards, these started to get filled with all of their junk. Which today
this was not a fraternity house at Portland State, I should say.
No. So we started to, the typical response to this would be to do some sampling of what's in the soil. We would screen it with 1/4-inch screen. Then you do a finer screen. And some people have asked how we found things that are so small. It's because we go through with a pretty fine instrument to screen out all of the potential artifacts and evidence. I was not doing that though. Here's some of the things that we found in that top 2 or 2 to 3 feet of soil. Old jar lid, and you can see some of the dates on these. This is 1881, roughly. Early 1900s. 1906, 1912 for the dishware. Even though they're not complete, they're not intact, you could probably find fully intact similar things at an antique shop. But what you do, what you find in archaeology is you find them in their context. So there's different levels of stratigraphy that, I probably didn't say that right, where it tells a story about who was doing what and when, and you find everything in context. So even though we only have this piece, that has some meaning because we can date that piece. And we can say where it's from. We can give some clue about the socioeconomic status of who's living there, what their lifestyle was like. And then we also find a lot of other household items, like children's toys, and these are parts of a tea set. And then all kinds of different buttons that are indicative of someone's clothing and pocket watch pieces and other pins. And then just a toothbrush that is made out of bone. These are a lot of the same things that you and I have today, but just different types of it. And then other things we found on this site, feel free to jump in if you have anything you want to add. We found foundation remnants. So in the 30s, the site had been bulldozed to make way for a gas station. And we found these perfectly intact brick foundations that actually were great repositories for little pieces of glass and other things that were probably at the stoop or in the subfloor of whoever was living there. And it was just really exciting to see all of these things in one spot, and you can attribute it to that house. And so we have all of these things that have been collected, and they're actually, I'll just tell you this now, a lot of it went to the Oregon Museum of Natural and Cultural History, and that's where it's available for researchers and archaeologists who want to do a little bit more in-depth research into the what we found. This is a light rail project, not a archaeological research project. So we went through quite a bit of preserving and curating what we found, but there's other work that can build off of what we've learned so far. And then there's this other feature, just a little bit ways. This was what was in the middle of what was Lincoln Street before the light rail project came through. So the trench was getting built through here. This is a little trench for our light rail communications and signals conduit. And the backhoe just went right through here. And then all of these artifacts, the glasses and bottles, just spilled out. It's a treasure trove of artifacts. And of course, I got called in, and so did our archaeologists. And this is a site where we felt like we needed to do a controlled excavation, make sure that we're not impacting something that's really significant. So we did an excavation here. You can see we do it in, I think it's 16 or 18 inch squares, and they go down every 4 inches at a time. They do all the screening. And it's a real, real laborious process, but it makes sure that we don't miss anything. One thing they noticed was that the color of the rock, and it may not be visible for all you out here, but the color of the dirt actually varied a bit, and you could tell a definite pattern of what was an unlined privy of some sort, and another privy. Great. So we went down all the way to the bottom to when there weren't any more artifacts. We knew we were going to impact this site even more, so we wanted to make sure we knew what we're getting into. But we found a wonderful collection of bottles, and it was all associated with the same site. And this had been in Southwest Lincoln, kind of on the edge of it before 1889. And when you look at a lithograph from 1879, you can really see just on the edge of that street where that was located. But in 1889, like I mentioned, the sewer came through and the street was widened, and then it was lost forever until we came through. And we found all these wonderful old pieces, old glassware, apothecary bottles from the druggist. This one actually is on display in the back here, and it says it's from a druggist at First and Market in downtown Portland. So personalized items like that reflect the business community here. And then some whiteware, tureen, soup tureen lid, and other flatware. So I think one of the things that Chet mentioned before when we were talking is that a lot of these are indicative of a time period before refrigeration, a time period before we had plastics. So this is how people lived. They had a lot of glass bottles, and they had a lot of jars that really kept their food safe and for longer periods of time.
Why don't you go to the next map and just to tie in those last images, if you did a census or looked at the Portland directory, which was like the phone book first published in the early 1870s, for this period of time, this is, some of you will know, before 1888, 1889, before the first bridge was thrown across the river, although it looks like they're getting going on it. But This was South Portland. This was an area that had been settled by primarily Russian Jews. German Jews had arrived a generation earlier and settled elsewhere in the city. Russian Jews, Italians were in essence pushed south into South Portland. So if you do a combination of the archaeology and then let's call it the sociology from historical records, and there are a lot of historic records from this era in various archives in Portland, you can get a pretty good sense of who was living here, what they were doing, what they were eating, what kinds of work they did, where their kids went to school. I have a pretty good sense of life here. This Markham Gulch down here, this, of course, is Tanner Springs as it comes down out of Portland Heights and wends its way down through Goose Hollow and then heading across northwest Portland into, ultimately into the river around Centennial Mill. So up here, Markham Hill, where OHSU is now, and the gulch that through which the freeway, I-5, or 405 rather, runs as it goes down toward the river before it intersects with I-5 that comes across the Markham Bridge. So you get a sense of the landscape with this old map that sometimes when we're driving through here, we just don't get that anymore because so much of the land, of course, has been flattened out for roads and houses and commercial buildings. The other thing that you can see down here, down by the river on both sides, is just how marshy it was, or what they called swampy. Not a word we would use nowadays. It's wetlands now. But gives you a sense of what the landscape was like, what the geology was like at the time the city was settled, and as transportation lines were being built, railroad lines, roads, and soon the interurban and streetcar lines running along and then soon across the river. And of course these scenes, these kinds of posters, let's call them, they were advertisements. Cities across the country were producing these as soon as they could lithograph in color. These were used as advertisements to promote the city. Soon you would see them with, here they even have names of prominent buildings, but they'd have buildings, prominent buildings around the edges. Basically, these were printed up and sent to post offices and newspapers around the world to promote growth in a particular city. So this may not look particularly attractive to us, but it was intended to market the city.
So here's another site we came across, an industrial site, so a bit different from what we have shown you so far. It's located right at Harrison and NATO Parkway, remnants of the Iron Fireman Plant. This is a building that was in production during World War II and had a fire during that time. So here's foundation remnants. We saw these big foundations, obviously not residential in nature. Found a lot of machine parts and then evidence of burning material that's been burned. So we did some research and we found out what it belonged to, and you know, we determined it wasn't something necessarily significant for preservation, but it's something that we looked into and wanted to share with you today. So if you look at a Sanborn map, you can see, you know, this used to be called the Smith and Watson Iron Works. It's from early 1900s, maybe even beyond earlier than 1900. But they had a machine shop, pottery shop, storage room, and then we were coming in with a bike improvement right along the side of NATO Parkway. And here's a picture from, I think, the 30s, which shows kind of how big this structure was at the time. And then we came across this article. This is a huge fire, maybe one of the bigger ones in Portland's history. It was in 1944 during World War II. And actually, this was one of the plants that was supporting or supplying the Liberty ships, which were being constructed in the shipyards in Portland at the time. We were one of the major shipyard manufacturers during the war effort. But there were 26 ship engines discussed in this article that were destroyed as a result of this fire. So kind of a significant setback, but it was just an interesting piece of history. And my office is a block away from this. So it was really neat to tie in the past with what's now just kind of a lawn, basically, off the edge of NATO. And then there's another site as we're getting a little bit closer to South Waterfront. This is a historic refuse pile. Just off the edge of Southwest Moody. We found it when we were doing some grading along the hillside on the other side of I-5, closer to Moody. And then we did a controlled excavation. We saw evidence of something's not right. It doesn't look like regular native dirt. And we found a large amount of oyster shells in addition to other artifacts. And you know, we still haven't figured out exactly why so many oyster shells. It could have been, we've had some theories that maybe it's an oyster road, like something to keep people from, you know, from it getting too muddy. But a lot of the oysters, most of them, were actually the native oyster, that went extinct around the early 1900s. And then we found a few of the Japanese oysters that had been imported from Asia around 1902. So those help date the site. And based on that and the stratigraphy of the artifacts, it looked like there was a rapid succession of dumping that went on here by the neighborhood around 1907 to 1920. And it's amazing that the archaeologists can pinpoint information like that based on what they found. Some of these are a lot older, obviously, than 1907, but it's the refuse and when it gets actually dumped. But we have some decorative glassware, household items, bottles, an old barber coin from 1892. And I think a few of these are actually over there in the corner if you want to look at them after. So if you look at that awesome lithograph again, you can actually see right where that pile must have been. And you see this small little neighborhood right over here. And you can just imagine mom and dad yelling at their kid, throw that garbage out. And you know, they have one little goat path and he just drops it off the side of the road. And then that's what we found.
So this is a scene from almost South Waterfront. You can see the toe of Ross Island up there. This is before the bridge was built, Ross Island Bridge. There were a number of shipbuilding and lumber mills, shipbuilding plants and lumber mills down along what's now South Waterfront in OHSU parking lot, the new Schnitzer campus. And what you also can see from this is how much of this wetlands is out there. It's now would be very contaminated. But this is also illustrates why there was so much dredging along the Willamette River from the mouth of the river 15 miles north up past Ross Island. You'd have all of those creeks, Stevens, Johnson, others, that would be carrying mud, especially during rainy seasons, into the river, filling it up, and Corps of Engineers would get in there and have to dredge it out. And also, just from a photograph like this, you get a pretty good sense of what the economy was like in this part of the city. This was, you know, we think of South Waterfront and South Portland being primarily residential, those ethnic neighborhoods, European ethnic neighborhoods. But they were also industrial. So there's, you know, there's sort of a, again, in planning parlance, a sociology going on there. You know, you could put industrial plants, loud, smelly, dangerous plants, right next to residential neighborhoods, as long as, of course, those neighborhoods were, you know, you didn't have to worry for votes and bribes and whatever else.
We did a presentation at Oregon Historical Society. Actually, Joe Reese did it from Archaeological Investigations Northwest. And someone asked at the end of the presentation why we didn't find the Native American village that had been in this location umpteen years ago, thousands of years ago maybe. And this is a good reason why. There's been a lot of change over time. And so when we're going through, we're just kind of touching upon the upper 10 or so feet. And that's been vastly disturbed by not just recent activities, but activities 100 years ago like this.
I should also add another story. I was chairing a couple years ago this committee that named the new bridge, Tillicum Crossing, and I was really pushing for a native name of some sort, and we were looking for the name of a village along the river, either on this side of the river or the other side where the bridge ends. Weren't able to find anything. Spoke with a number of tribal scholars, and by and large, it's flooding, as Joe intimated. Before there were, you know, just think of the 96 flood, 48 flood, on back. When we had dams, so push that back before the era of dams and water control further upriver. You can only imagine the the torrent that would come down here. It would pretty much scour, just like this earthquake is doing, would scour the landscape on both sides of the river, basically probably cutting down the soil 2-3 feet or so and removing virtually any kind of most human remnants.
So we're gonna move across the river now. We're at Central East Side. Found a couple things right over here. This is Southeast Carruthers. So someone had mentioned to me earlier today that they started to use these awesome new bike facilities that were constructed. And yeah, that's great. And one of them actually is over one of the sites that we encountered, and the other one's not too far away. So before we get into that, just a brief picture back in time. This is what that area looked like about a little over 100 years ago. It's actually water. And there were these trestles that's how you cross the water to get from one place to the other. And filling this area didn't happen until a little bit later. So this is Carruthers, which is now that bike street. And we found all of these logs that seemed to be interconnected. It was actually one of the trestles that crossed through Stevens Slough at the time. And it was in use up until the 40s or 60s, and it went to this Inman Paulson Mill, I think it was called. But basically the large mill that is unmissable, and I'll show a picture a little bit later, and it's basically where OMSI is today. But it was interesting to see a piece of the slough, evidence of that crossing right in our path. And here's a little bit more research that was done to show how quickly that slough filled up. And even the newspapers at the time talked about the progress of filling this water body, this natural resource that we would consider today was nothing more than a hindrance for travel. And even this newspaper article says, "Good work now in progress means the passing of elevated roadways and the general use of solid embankment." Well, what they filled it with isn't actually too solid, but we had to do a little extra excavation. But this is kind of the general sentiment of the era, is that a lot of industrialization, a lot of progress from that industrialization, and not so much caring about the birds and the fish. Here's a picture of that mill, Inman Paulson. Is that what I said? But it was a giant mill. These are giant hills of sawdust. And a lot of that sawdust is what filled the slough. Not quite solid embankment. But that's what was put in there. But that wasn't the only thing. People threw other things in there, like discarded buildings and mills. So as we're going through there with our bulldozers, we notice something that's not quite sawdust anymore, and it's these wood contraptions. I've got a little closer up picture. That's me. So here's the wheels, and you can tell they're a little bit charred on the edges. It looks like it'd been burned of some sort. Then you see these metal contraptions and other parts of wheels. And when you put all of this together, we did a little bit of research. We think they may have been somehow affiliated with a mill that was somewhere in the area that may have burned down previously. Obviously not significant in terms of, you're not gonna take this and put it in a museum, but it's evidence of how things were different and really different in this part of town 100 years ago. And we found a bit of that history. Here's a picture of like a real mill wheel that's actually operation. It may be a reconstruction or something, but it kind of shows you how things would work. There's some metal, there's some wood. And Gideon Tibbetts had a mill not too far away that had burned down shortly or around the time of the filling of that slough. So this could have been the wheel. It's really hard to make a conclusive remark to that effect, but it's kind of fun to think about. That we actually identified it. Then we're gonna go a little bit further south. So this is 17th Avenue and then McLaughlin Boulevard. McLaughlin, We didn't actually do any digging for this project in Westmoreland Park, but we did have a side project which restored a wetland in that area. So we did quite a bit of research into the park in order to determine, you know, the significance of that site historically. Wow, I didn't really know, but apparently I'm odd man out.
This is Fred Meyer, and the reason I wanted to put Fred in here, can you all hear me back there?
Yep.
The reason I wanted to put Fred in, this doesn't seem to be working, so I'm going to speak. I'm going to use Joe.
Is in the 1930s, Fred Meyer owned a store downtown, opened up another store on the east side, and in the 1930s, basically came up with a concept, and that was to begin to look beyond where most people were looking to where he thought Portlanders would settle in all quadrants of the city except the Northwest, interestingly. Basically, because it was probably limited by the hills, and you know there wasn't any potential. And he wasn't looking out into the suburbs. He was basically looking in the larger Portland metro area. And it was in the mid to late 1940s where he began to act on this vision that he had. And he actually, I did an oral history of him in the mid-1970s, and he articulated this quite clearly. That he would buy up large pieces of land and just hold on to them with the idea that at some point he would build a shopping center. I don't even know if he called them a shopping center then, but some kind of facility. So here was someone who was acting on a bet. He was looking at maps of the city and transit lines and places where you could build a lot of houses. So he was already thinking about what we call transit-oriented development long before the concept was even invented. So I've always liked this image of this visionary who hardly looks like that in this photograph, but he really was.
So since we're going down 17th Avenue, I thought it would be good to give a little bit of background on the history of the transit network that the city had. Since we were passing by what used to be called TriMet World Headquarters on 17th and Holgate, like I mentioned, our office is downtown now, but we still have some offices there. But anyway, we had a great streetcar system back then. It had multiple lines going throughout the region. This actually says, city and suburban lines reach all sections of the city of Portland. And here's a map from back then. I think this is early 1900s, probably before 1910. And you see streetcars everywhere. This is how people got around. And a lot of different agencies ran different aspects of the streetcar. So you had different types of vehicles, and you had different gauges of track.
Joe probably can't admit it because he works for TriMet, but in 1912, this may be in the 1912.
I think you're right.
Map. It wasn't TriMet then, obviously, but it was you know essentially TriMet, and the Portland system was recognized as second only to Los Angeles's, which had the greatest streetcar system in the country at the time, which is I've always found intriguing, which is how you connected all those strange little towns that have now become neighborhoods in Los Angeles. But you just look at the sheer number of lines on which you could get a streetcar. You know, you could get from here to down to what's now Pioneer Courthouse Square in a matter of about 7 minutes. Quite a system, and about every three to five minutes, another streetcar would come by. So. Always impressed me. The other mention is that I need to keep speaking or this thing seems to die. I have to wake it up. is you could get on an interurban from Union Station down to Salem in about an hour, and the trains would leave every few minutes, which meant that legislators and others who had business would get on the train, have breakfast, go down to the state capitol, do their business, get back on the train, come back up.
By lunchtime,
so press it.
And if you look right here, that's where TriMet's bus yard is today. And I didn't put it on this slideshow, but we actually have a family tree of TriMet that shows all the different organizations that really led into and fed the organization that is TriMet today. And we inherited a lot of those assets, including this site. So this is Holgate right here. This is 17th. These are the center street shops. And this is a great little article from 1913. I'll just read one sentence, sorry. The new shops are located at 17th and Center, East Portland, on a 14.6 acre site, easily accessible to the standard and narrow gauge lines, both of which systems are operating by the Portland Company. And the reason that's significant is a couple slides, but there were two different gauges. The width of the trackway varied depending on the vehicle that was being used. These are some photos from inside those buildings. Obviously, they maintained trolleys, they worked on track, and just a really complex operation that we had going on there. And a lot of it went away because we found rubber tires, but we still use the overhead traction. But we found this section of dual gauge track right off of 17th Avenue. And it may be the last section of dual gauge track left in the city. So we cut it out, and it's sitting somewhere. I don't know exactly where. People who care a lot more than I do have it. It's at the Oregon Heritage Rail Heritage Foundation Museum.
Wall Street.
There we go. And that museum is right outside of our OMSI station on the new Orange Line. So we've kept it in the area. This is another really interesting site. Got a lot of attention. Really unassuming property that we acquired. Future site of a substation for the Orange Line. You wouldn't think twice about removing this building, would you? But we did. We have a really strong deconstruction program. When we demolish buildings, we try to reuse as much as possible. But we did a little bit of research into the property, and we found an oral history that had been reported in the Oregonian in the 70s. And this woman here, Lois Tharp, mentioned in the article that this nighttime diner was converted to its present use from a rail car. So we had a pretty good idea there may be a rail car inside this thing. So we went inside. She's pretty awesome, if you read the rest of that article. If you go inside, you can find evidence of that building in there. And folks, not that exciting. But you can see the top of the rail car. And we invited people from the Oregon Rail and Heritage Foundation and other volunteer groups that are interested just as much as we are in using as much of this trolley car as possible. And so we slowly deconstructed it. And you can still see the exterior of that building. It's just amazing. The streetcar, the trolley was right there. And the windows were connected to it. And then you go inside and you can see more and more. And they actually found quite a bit of instruments and pieces of metal, and the wood in there apparently was really worth saving. And not only that, but we also saved a lot of wood from the rest of the outer building. And this is what it looked like on the outside. And some people in this audience probably know more than me, but I think part of this actually was saved, and it, with the intention of repurposing it as a display, either at Orff or another museum. So a great story of salvage and finding, and who knows what you're gonna find when you do a little bit of research. And this is Westmoreland Park. This is the site where, this is what it used to look like. It was a duck pond, really bad for the environment. It was a heat sink. This is a salmonoid stream, Crystal Springs Creek. And this was doing no good for the salmon. So part of our project, we went in and we used our mitigation dollars and worked with the Army Corps of Engineers and the City Bureau of Environmental Services and Parks and Rec. And they had the city already had a master plan to restore this creek. So we worked with them and helped fund the restoration effort. And as part of that, we did quite a bit of research into the history of the park. This is a picture looking back in the 1930s. This is the McLaughlin. ODOT called it the superhighway at the time. You can see all the beautiful oaks that adorn McLaughlin are about as tall as me today. And you can see the duck pond. That was one of the first features they put in. But it's really interesting to see how this park progressed over time. But before it was a park, it was an airfield. This is one of two airfields at the time. I think the other one was Swan Island. But at the time, they really thought that Portland would become this aviation center. And you know, the newspapers and all the industrials were just excited about the prospect of an aviation industry in the city. I think it kind of went to Seattle, but hey, we've got these old great pictures to look at. There was actually a bombing plane that landed in Westmoreland. How odd is that?
Did it take off again?
I think so. One of these articles actually talks about, if you read in through it, they were talking about the quality of the landing strips, and it was just an emerging industry, and they really wanted better airfields in Portland at the time. And I had done all this research a while back, and then I heard about an article in the Oregonian where the mayor said, Mayor Hales, current mayor, who lives in Eastmoreland, said a plane crashed in his front yard at some point in history. So I looked it up and I found these photos, and he's about 9 blocks away from that airfield. And that happened in 1919, so likely associated with the proximity to the airfield that was at Westmoreland Park. That's what it looks like today. That's the crash. So as the park's getting developed in 1936, obviously Great Depression, people are farming on the park instead of playing. Rough times. 1939 comes around, the Works Progress Administration under Roosevelt, people being put to work, rebuilding the park and making it the park that it was envisioned to be. And then this is what it looked like generally when it was done. But that area was transformed by our project, and that's what it looks like today. So quite a bit different, much more fish friendly. Just a little side detour into this part of the history along the alignment. We actually put together a much more exhaustive slideshow of the history of this park, and it's going to be on display at the MAX station on the electronic transit tracker displays. So when you're looking at when the MAX is coming, you can also look at some historic photos, keep you busy. So another little detour, we're in Crystal Creek. This is in north of downtown Milwaukee. Just a small little site, another little weird discovery that we came across. So we found these concrete foundations in the backyard of a home. Crystal Creek, not to be confused with Crystal Springs Creek. This is much smaller, and it ran through this area, and it was just so overgrown with blackberries and ivy that we had no clue what we'd find. But we found this concrete structure there. So we did a little bit of research, wondered what it could be associated with. There was a historic feature in this location, or very close by, that we uncovered when we did some research. So it used to be Crystal Lake Park, and it was just maybe 50-100 feet away at most, where this image was taken. So we wondered if it was associated with that. And at the time, there were a lot of these little amusement parks at the end of the trolley lines or along them. This one talks about Crystal Lake Park, a dandy little picnic resort close to town. Plenty of good, clean amusement and dancing. Now open. So just a nice little detour that was close by. This is what it looks like today. It's fully restored, and there's no more blackberry, and we took what we found out to be a pool, a swimming pool, that probably was filled with water from Crystal Creek at the time. A really weird little find. And then we're in Milwaukie. So I put a star here, even though we didn't find anything during construction. This is one of those locations where when we did the pre-construction surveys, we did some digging. We found evidence of pre-contact settlement in this location. But we had a pretty light footprint when we built this bridge. We just had one pier, even close to the water, and it was outside of the water even. So we didn't actually come into contact with anything while we were there. But we did have monitors present for that work. But here we did come across something. This is right across McLaughlin Boulevard. While doing digging a utility trench, came across another brick-lined shaft feature. You know, we know from now that those are filled with a lot of goodies, so we were excited. And there was just a hole in the ground at first. And then we did some shoring up of the walls and even had to put some ventilation in, some of the perils of urban archaeology. And we did a controlled excavation. I say we, but actually the contractor. But they found some interesting things. This site used to be back. This Sanborn map shows that there was a pottery manufacturer here at the turn of the century, from the 1880s up through the 1920s. And then that pottery shop was again reused in the 1940s after the war through the 50s. You can see it says kiln. It also says vacant. I think this Sanborn map is right after the earlier pottery shop had closed. But we found items that weren't necessarily pottery. There were a lot of women's items, perfume bottles, an old Noxema glass case from the 30s or 40s. I only know those come in plastic. And then we found some other household items, jars and whatnot, and housewares. So this is clearly from the interlude, the period in between the pottery, where someone was obviously living on the site. And we know from census records who that is. I can find the name if you want to ask me later. But we also found these evidence of pottery. This is some glazed samples. So this is what a potter would bring to potential buyers that are interested in purchasing some pottery. And before the age of plastics, almost everything was pots or glassware. So they did different glazing samples, and we found that along with the word fish, which I think may be associated. There was a Fisher Pottery, was the first pottery company there. So from the 1880s or 90s to the 1920s. And then we go all the way down. This is towards the end of the alignment. This is what is now the trolley trail, the last segment of it that was built by the Portland-Milwaukie project due to timing issues. As we were regrading the hillside, the contractor came forward and said, we found something that looks like it's not dirt, it's brick, and it appears to be in a pattern of some sort. So we brought out the professionals, they did a controlled little dig, and they uncovered what looks like a brick drainage feature. And we looked at all the historical maps, and we couldn't really see anything that specifically said it was a drainage feature. So it's just something accessory to what was, at the time, Portland Traction Company had a trolley that went all the way along here, and it was built in 1897 or close to 1890. So this is probably close to the age of this feature here. But it not only came in brick, it came in cobblestone. And then in one section, it actually ended and it went into a corrugated pipe. And so when we mapped this with GIS, we found that pipe correlates to where there was a station. And the station was called Lakewood Station, which we have a picture of from the 1930s. We have a lot of photos along this alignment from the 1930s, by the way. That's when ODOT built the McLaughlin Superhighway. So they photographed everything, just like we photograph everything with the light rail. So a lot of great history. but you can see the stairs going up the side of the hill. Once the vegetation was removed, you can really see where that station would have been had it still been around today. This is a picture of the trolley operating, and you can sort of see a hint of that drainage feature. And this is what it looked like as we were going through there and covering bits and pieces of it. It was a pretty large feature, not something that we could really preserve in place, but what we did is data preservation. We went and we tried to find the extent of the feature, and then we documented how it was built and dimensions and whatnot, and that's all saved. And we even saved samples of the brick and the cobblestone. Actually, all of the cobblestone ended up being preserved, and even though we're not inside the city of Portland, we didn't take it to the city parks and rec, but we reused it in part of the art foundations. So if you're walking along the trolley trail or biking along it today, you'll see a bunch of great artworks made out of, they were carved out of the trees, some of the trees that were removed from the site. And so that wood artwork sits on foundations that have these cobblestones in them. So a really great tie to the past. Here's another view of that cobblestone structure. You don't really see many of these in the Portland region, but on the East Coast, apparently you see them quite a bit, and they're a lot older, obviously. But this is from Mount Vernon. This is taken by Joe Reese from Archaeological Investigations when she was up there. And I was just there a couple months ago, too. But this is what it looks like today. It's a nice functional trolley trail. I think there's a sort of sea. There's a wood, one of the sculptures right there. So that was the end of the slideshow. But we wanted to leave you with pictures of an interurban line, which is really similar to the Max line that we have today. So we have two little side shots, tie in the history with the present.